Previously, we talked about the Bloch sphere, and today we're going to talk a little bit more about how single-qubit operations are implemented and what that looks like on the Bloch sphere. As a review, single-qubit operations are simply just rotations around the Bloch sphere if we're using the Bloch sphere as a visual representation of a qubit. So a qubit state represents a point on the Bloch sphere. For example, the NOT gate takes a state and rotates it around the x-axis of the Bloch sphere. That rotation is a rotation of pi, or 180 degrees. The H gate, or superposition gate, takes a qubit state and rotates it around the y-axis of the Bloch sphere. So that allows us to start from our ket 0 and ket 1 and end up in a spot of equal superposition at either the plus state or the minus state, respectively. Let's take a little bit of a deeper look at the Bloch sphere. So we have qubit state falling on the surface of the sphere. And since we have that requirement that we have 100% chance of falling in either ket 0 or ket 1 upon measurement, our radius for our Bloch sphere is going to be equal to 1. It's a unit sphere. So single qubit operations rotate the qubit state around the surface of the sphere. And these rotations are either in the x, y, or z direction, if they're around the x, y, or z axis, respectively. So we have a new way to describe a qubit if we want to describe it in terms of our angles, theta and phi. Here we have our probability amplitudes represented by the function cosine theta over 2 and EI phi sine theta over 2. And then we have our phase aspect, which is introduced by this EI phi factor outside of our ket 1. So in this example, let's confirm the location of the ket minus, which is the result of taking a ket 1 and evolving it with the Hadamard operation so that we're at the back of the Bloch sphere in a 50-50 superposition of 0 and 1 with a phase aspect. So we see that phase, that minus sign on the ket 1 part of our qubit state. So we have this first representation of qubit state used here, but now we're going to confirm the location using our new representation. So let's think about what we would plug in for theta and phi. So starting with theta, we see that we have a rotation of pi over 2, and then for phi, we have a rotation of pi. So remember, theta is the angle away from the positive z-axis, and phi is the angle away from the positive x-axis. So plugging those values to our equation, remember we have our identities from trigonometry that we can apply here. We end up getting the minus state. So our qubit state is equal to the minus state once we solve this equation. Some important observations. Our angle theta influences the probability of observing a ket 0 or ket 1. So if we are at the equator of the Bloch sphere, so that would be a theta value of pi over 2, that would result in a 50% chance of observing the state ket 0 and a 50% chance of observing the state ket 1. As theta increases, you're more likely to observe a 1. So as theta increases all the way to pi, our chances of observing a 1 become larger. So our angle phi, what does that do? That influences the phase between ket 0 and ket 1. And remember, phase is a little tricky. It's never measured, but it's really important for quantum information because constructive and deconstructive interference allows quantum informatics to have its power when implemented within algorithms. So we refer to this phase difference as relative phase. So that would be the negative sign in our negative superposition state. That would be the relative phase here between ket 0 and ket 1. So we also have global phase. And this is common to both ket 0 and ket 1 and is expressed as a coefficient multiplied by the quantum state. So for example, you'll sometimes see a global phase of negative 1 or I. This has no observable effect on quantum state. So often it's just discarded. So for example, if we have this negative sign here associated with our quantum state, if we look at what that would be distributed between ket 0 and ket 1, It's common to both, and we oftentimes just discard it whenever we're representing our qubit state. So let's look at global phase in a little bit more depth and provide a practical example. When we look at physical systems, we're often more concerned with differences rather than absolutes. So here, pretend you and your friend are standing together and one of them moves away. When we're thinking about calculating the velocity at which the friend moved away, you could use the center of the Earth as your reference point for your calculation, or you could use the center of the sun. The point of reference really doesn't matter in the calculation. What really matters is the difference. That's why global phase is something we tend to discard in quantum computing when we're looking at qubit state. So we looked at specific qubit operations, but let's generalize them. What if I want to just rotate anywhere around the Bloch sphere? Well, there's equations to do that. So first we'll look at the general X rotation. So here we have gamma that we're trying to rotate. We're trying to rotate an angle gamma around the X axis of the Bloch sphere. So any arbitrary degree, we would use the following equation. If we wanted to rotate around the Y axis, so anywhere around the Y axis, we would use the second equation. Finally, if we wanted to arbitrarily rotate around the Z axis, and that would adjust our phi part of our Bloch sphere, we could use the following equation. Let's look at an example. So let's calculate the rotation around the X axis, so Rx of pi, so 180 degree rotation around the X axis. So here's our equation for R axis rotations. We're going to substitute pi for all of the gammas. Remember, we can use our relations from trigonometry between cosine, sine, and our angles. This would be our matrix that represents the Rx of pi rotation. So let's look at that a little bit more. We just talked about how global phase is something we typically tend to disregard in quantum computing. So we factor out that factor of negative I, and that looks pretty similar to the NOT gate or the X gate that we've been talking about since the beginning of class. So global phase, as we just talked about, has no observable impact on quantum state. So we say that Rx of pi is equal to X, so our NOT gate, up to a global phase of negative I. Let's look at a second example. So now we're going to calculate Rz of pi. So once again, our z of pi is going to represent a rotation of pi around the z axis, so the one that goes up and down on the Bloch sphere. So we have our rotation equation, or we have our rotation matrix. We plug in values of pi for our gamma. And that results in a matrix that has some phase. But if we pull out that negative I factor, we end up with the Z operation. So our phase flip operation. Once again, because global phase has no observable impact on quantum state, we can say that Rz of pi is equal to Z up to global phase of negative I. So a couple of key points to take away. Single qubit gates can be thought of as rotation operations, and those are visualized as rotations around the X, Y, and Z axis of the Bloch sphere. We introduce the Rx, Ry, and Rz operations, and those allow arbitrary qubit states to be created. And remember, global phase on qubit state can generally be ignored.